Now joined in the studio by Rabbi Jacqueline Nino from the Emmanuel Synagogue. She'll vote yes in the postal survey. Reverend David Auld, rector of Glen Quarry Anglican Church in New South Wales, he's voting no. Ali Kadri is the spokesperson for the Islamic Council of Queensland. He joins us from Brisbane and is undecided on which box he'll tick. And with us from Canberra, Jesuit priest Frank Brennan is Professor of Law at the Australian Catholic University. Father Brennan is also the Chief Executive of Catholic Social Services. Underlining the split among leading Australian Catholics, Frank Brennan will tick yes. Welcome all of you to Late Line.
Thank you,
Emma. I have in anticipation asked our guests if it's okay to call them by their first names for brevity's sake, so we'll launch in. In the 50s, when the Menzies government introduced uniform divorce laws across the country, every religious leader expressed a certain outrage about that. But eventually a way was found to accommodate religious freedoms. Why would legislating same-sex marriage be any different? Jackie.
I actually don't think it is any different. I think that there are ways to protect people who choose or who feel for their religious reasons that they can't perform a same-sex wedding, and at the same time giving people the religious freedom, like me, who would like to perform same-sex weddings and currently are not able to do so under the law, the freedom to be able to do that.
And what would your elders in the Jewish faith in Australia and beyond think about your decision potentially to officiate a same-sex wedding?
My denomination of Judaism, so that's the progressive Jewish community, but also I speak in this sense for the Masorti Jewish community as well, are all overwhelmingly in favour. Our leadership has made many statements about the issue in favour of marriage equality and in favour of us performing same-sex wedding ceremonies. At the moment, we perform commitment ceremonies between couples of the same gender, but we would like to be able to call them a wedding and to be able to make them a marriage under the law, and to be able to do that, we need the law in Australia to change.
David Auld, back to my original question, if we've been able to accommodate for the divorce law change back in the 50s and then no-fault divorce in the 70s, why would this be any different in terms of being able to accommodate those religious freedoms?
Look, it's a great question. It's one that gets asked a lot. It does go to the heart of what the issue really is, that no-fault divorce is a kind of a dilution in a sense of what people think marriage is, whereas what we're talking about today is a redefinition of marriage itself from a man and a woman to something, well, I'm never quite hearing quite what the full definition is. So in terms of the actual issue on defining marriage.
Hold on, let me pull you up on that for 1 second, because the full definition at the moment of marriage in the Act is the union of a man and a woman to the exclusion of all others voluntarily entered into for life. The change that's being proposed is that the wording be changed to of two people.
Sure. So while the law is necessarily quite brief and reductionistic, not in a bad way, it does represent a fundamental underlying sense of what marriage is. If you go to people and say, what is marriage? They're going to talk about far more than just the couple of lines in the Constitution or the Marriage Act. So what we're trying to do is find a law that best represents what we think marriage is. You can't get it all in, but you need to get some fundamentals in. We're actually calling now for a radical redefinition of that, away from what we previously thought it was. And we can talk about, if you want to, about why marriage is what it is. One thing I want to take Jackie up on is the notion of religious freedom, and she defined it very narrowly in terms of what I, as a minister, am free to do. But actually, I think the reality is, and we see this already in many other Western countries where these changes have happened, is that religious freedom is far more important, not for ministers like me, but for my church members. And actually, it's more than just religious freedom. It's freedom of conscience for everybody. There are plenty of people who aren't religious who are against redefining marriage. And they're going to find themselves under increasing pressure, and already even are right now, simply for wanting to uphold the current law of the land.
Frank Brennan.
Yes.
Sorry, there you are. Sorry, Frank Brennan, when it comes to this particular question of being able to accommodate religious freedoms, how do you balance that in your mind?
Well, I think we've got the predicament at the moment. We're dealing with what I'd call an indicative type plebiscite. And the question is, well, Do you say yes to this provided the Parliament does something? Or do you say no, not until Parliament has considered these things? My own view as a citizen is to say, well, I think these are complex questions of religious freedom, particularly in Australia where we do not have a Commonwealth Human Rights Act. And I think finding the balance on these things is very difficult. The Australian Law Reform Commission has said it needs further consideration. The Senate Committee said it needs further consideration. So for me, it's simply a prudential question. Are these matters best thrashed out in the plebiscite campaign, or is the plebiscite campaign one of saying we give the clearance to the Parliament to start the hard work? And I opt for the latter.
Because, of course, in the Catholic tradition, already when someone is a divorcee, they cannot expect to be married in the Catholic Church.
Sure. Well, we're dealing, I think, with, you've raised questions about divorce law that were changed, no-fault divorce. All of those changes to the civil law, of course, Emma, meant that civil marriage came to be seen to be more and more different from religious marriage. And let's remember, we're dealing with a very changing social institution. I mean, at the time of Federation, just about everyone was married in Australia by a minister of religion. By 1999, over half the marriages being performed were by civil celebrants. Now, more than three quarters are performed by civil celebrants. And as I say, and it's not to be in any way derogatory about civil marriage, but it is basically in legal terms now a contract which parties enter into. It can be terminated on 1 year's notice, and it's not necessary for the parties to have a commitment to bearing and nurturing each other's children, even if they have the capacity to do so. Now, those things are very different from the notion of marriage in my church tradition. And so the question is whether or not now there should be a further change to that civil law while retaining religious freedoms.
And we'll go to those specific protections and what they might look like shortly. But I'll come to you, Ali. You're undecided among the four panellists here. Is it the religious freedom question that is the one you're grappling with the most as you try to form a view?
Two things here. Well, first and foremost, a marriage as a Muslim is a religious institution for us. And in Islam, it's pretty clear that it's between man and a woman. And as far as I understand, even within the secular law, the marriage itself has been inherited or taken from religious aspects. So changing that is changing something which is religious, in my opinion, and that kind of leans me towards a no vote. Having said that, we live in a country where a lot of things are legal which are forbidden in my religion. So alcohol is forbidden for Muslims, adultery is forbidden for Muslims, but it's legal in Australia. So that is kind of an argument on the yes side of things. But as a Muslim, what I struggle with and what I will struggle with, and hence I will either vote no or I will choose not to vote, is the fact that marriage is a religious institution for a Muslim, and to change it in any way, shape or form, or to support the change of it in any way, shape or form, would go against my religious values. Having said that, I mean, look, let's be honest, this is not the biggest issue. There are a lot of critical questions which are unanswered at the moment, and if politicians would have discussed this instead of a plebiscite, we would have been able to find the answers of the questions which I still today have, and nobody's answered. I mean, would that affect the religious freedoms? Would that impact on education of the children? So those questions, till they get answered, I think, I would stick to no or not voting at all.
The debate essentially turns on whether you think, David, there is an equivalence between heterosexuality and homosexuality.
Yeah, I think it actually comes down to that, doesn't it? So we get this language of equality, but actually legal equality has essentially already been established, and the last Labor government did that, and Tanya Plibersek regularly has talked about her pride in achieving legal equality. And so while there's a couple of things that could be tightened up, we could, for example, have a Commonwealth-wide civil union act. It's essentially there. This is about something fundamentally deeper. It's actually asking the state to do something which I don't think we've ever asked the state to do before. It's to take two relationships and to say, look, fundamentally, they're the same. And everyone needs to treat them as though they're the same. And there are some people who in good conscience will go, look, I bear no ill will towards homosexuals, and I actually want freedom for homosexuals to couple and have protection in law, but these are not the same.
Why not?
Well, it's basic biology. Even my eight-year-old, I don't mean to be rude, even my eight-year-old can tell you this because I've done the birds and the bees with him. A heterosexual relationship is naturally orientated in ways that homosexual relationships aren't. The principal difference, of course, is that heterosexual relationships are orientated towards sexual reproduction and the nurturing of children, which is why, of course, the government then needs to take an interest in those relationships for the sake of
the parties. But you would also know that something like 17% of couples are infertile.
Sure, absolutely. So when a couple's infertile, and my wife and I, when we were first married, we grappled with this ourselves. When a couple's infertile, we recognise something's gone wrong and we seek to rectify it. When a homosexual couple spend the night in bed and no one falls pregnant, we don't go, oh, something's gone wrong. We see that as the natural outcome of that relationship. So just the fact that some people are infertile doesn't actually undermine the fact that heterosexual relationships in their essence, in their nature, are reproductive. So there's one big difference. The fact that you've got two different people coming together, a man and a woman, they are different, is different to having a man and a man and a woman and a woman coming together. So there are some fundamental differences. And I actually want to go, do you know what, it's all right to say they're different.
But being different is one thing, being equal is another. Let me go to Jackie. What's your view?
My view is that homosexual or same-sex relationships are exactly the same as a heterosexual relationship, and I don't believe that marriage is defined as a man and a woman simply and that's the end of it. I think it's about the relationship between that couple, and I think the second part of that definition that you read out is all important. It's about making an exclusive commitment to one another from a place of love and a place of connection. And when I read the scriptures of my tradition, I find that men and women were created in the image of God, and so there is a sanctity and holiness about us and about the way that we were created, and I believe that our sexuality is a reflection of that divine within us. And then we're told that men and women are not to be alone, we're created to be in relationship and to be connected, and I think it would be a very cruel and God and not one that I ascribe, you know, a vision of God that I ascribe to that would create people same-sex attracted and then deny them the possibility of a relationship and a union together and being able to sanctify that union in a holy space. And I think that sometimes with this debate, we're kind of getting a little bit off track and we're talking about a civil law. We're not talking about changing religious law. And I read the scriptures, and for me, my tradition, actually, I'm voting yes, not in spite of my tradition, but because of my tradition, and that compels me to do that.
Ali, hold on a second, sorry, because we have got four people to get through. Ali, on the question of whether this is about putting heterosexuality and homosexuality as equal, what's your view on that as an Australian and also as a Muslim Australian?
Look, I think as a both, I don't consider both of them to be the same thing. I mean, those are two fundamentally different types of relationship. Religion accepts only one type of those relationship, which is a heterosexual relationship, and Australian law recognises both as of now. So that is how I see them. I don't see them as equal relationships. They're two different relationships. Having said that, as a Muslim, and it's pretty clear amongst the scholars of Islam that if somebody is homosexual, that does not take them out of the fold of Islam. They're still a Muslim. They can still continue doing the prayers, whatever they need to do. They should not be discriminated against when they come in to pray and so on and so forth. But when it comes to identifying them as a married couple, as Islamic religious rulings would be concerned, that cannot happen under Islam.
David Brennan, where does the Bible sit on this question?
Well, I don't see the Bible as being so relevant in terms of what the law should be, in that for me, I mean, what the Bible teaches us, of course, I mean, take Paul's letter to the Romans, which we read in church just this Sunday. Paul said, love is the only thing that cannot hurt your neighbour. So if we start with the idea of love and respect, of course, we want to give respect to homosexual couples as we do to heterosexual couples. And increasingly, we want to give respect and accord the dignity to the children of unions which are of homosexual families as well as heterosexual families. And so in that context, I think it's more about asking the question, regardless of what the Bible might say about notions of marriage, because let's remember, particularly in Old Testament times, you had polygamy. And definitely in Old Testament times, the law of Moses allowed divorce. And so you get into very difficult waters once you start trying to apply the Bible to the civil legal institutions in a pluralistic democratic society. I think it's about how do you give the respect to these couples? How does the civil law deal with the situation of increasing number of married homosexual couples coming from jurisdictions like the United States, Canada, United Kingdom, New Zealand? How do we accord those sorts of things? And what I think the Bible injuncts us to do is to work on the principles of respect and dignity.
Frank Brennan, I'm sorry I did call you David. I'm getting confused with my names, but we're running out of time. So a quick response from all of you about the fundamental religious protection you'd like to see enshrined in any legislation that would allow same-sex marriage. And perhaps I'll start with you, Ali.
The only thing I'd like to see is that protection for religious marriage celebrants to deny or decline the weddings or marriages for the same-sex couples, and to a freedom to educate or teach the religion as it is supposed to be taught within the schools, within Islamic schools or within religious houses without any hindrance or harm.
David.
Well, Christians love Jesus because of what he's done for them, and they're not going to walk away from him. And he speaks, I think, pretty clearly on marriage, says it's between a man and a woman. So I'm actually not worried about myself. I'm worried about the pensioners I have in my church congregation who are actually afraid to talk out about this. I'm worried about the young man in his 30s who works in the public service who they've just announced a safe space. And I said to him, do you feel safe? And he said, hell no. So I'm worried about those people. I'm worried about an increasingly coercive social thing we've got going on where people just feel afraid to even say, I don't agree. I mean, have you seen the No campaign is now saying it's okay to say no?
We're going to run out of time. Thank you, David. Quickly, Jackie, a quick word.
I think any protections that are required are already in existence in the law and in the Marriage Act as it stands now. So I think we just need to say yes and change the law and everyone will find their way.
A brief comment, Frank?
The protections are clearly not there in federal law. I would say we should adopt the provisions of sections 14 and 15 of the Victorian Charter of Rights, which is about freedom of conscience, freedom of religion, freedom of belief and freedom of expression. So yes, vote yes, but insist that these things have to be included in any legislation.
Hear, hear, Father
Thank you
Frank.
So much. Thank you so much, Frank, Ali, Jackie, David. Appreciate your time, all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.